Today we're going to kind of wrap up this series on giving thanks, I think, you know, unless the Lord prompts me to do another week. But Thanksgiving is coming up, and I've been trying to post my daily I'm thankful for, and it's cool, and meeting other people, you realize in the family of God, or in the body of Christ, we are family, and that family is it kind of had this revelation of forever family, right? Because our family ties, some, you know, I've met people that have cuts and severed ties with family members, and they like treat them like they're not family anymore. But in the faith, with the hope of eternity, when we look at each other as brothers and sisters in Christ, we're all God's children, then we have eternity to spend as family, right? Not just as people I know, but, you know, we are family. And even if I leave this church and go somewhere else, and one day in eternity we meet again, we'll still be family. Amen? And this morning I want to talk to you about giving thanks for the body of Christ. Because I've realized, I look back over this last year of sermons, and I think the Lord is doing something in that. I looked, and time and time again, I hit this point about talking about the body of Christ. In almost every series we've done this entire year, I've talked about the importance of the unity of the body and acting as a body, as the word says. And as we think about Thanksgiving coming up, I found this story about the first Thanksgiving, pretty interesting as we think about this subject. He said this: besides symbolizing a time when many of us gather to feast on turkey, cranberry sauce, and apple pie, what does the word truly mean? America's revered holiday was founded by a group of struggling pilgrims during the fall of 1621. Peter Marshall and David Manuel's account, The Light and the Glory, tells how the pilgrims at Plymouth Rock endured extreme hardship to pioneer a new land. 3 long months at sea aboard the Mayflower and a brutal winter left them ragged, malnourished, and susceptible to disease. During the first 4 months of that year, nearly half of the immigrants had succumbed to illness and died under the harsh strain of their barren lifestyle. The pilgrims' daily existence was a life or death battle to overcome constant hunger, sickness, and exposure to the elements. Crudely assembled houses made of mud daub were their only shelter from the icy New England weather. Now think about what just happened in Buffalo. 5 feet of snow, 6 feet of snow, causing houses to, you know, collapse. People are dying. Now imagine you take away all your solid 2x4 construction and cement foundation and replace it with some bendable trees and mud. And imagine enduring that winter. Because they were not yet knowledgeable about their new environments, agriculture, planting gardens in the hostile condition proved virtually fruitless. Every meal was portioned out meticulously. The death toll and constant reminder of their fragility rose steadily. At one point, only 5 men were well enough to care for the sick. Despite these tribulations, the pilgrims thanked the Lord every day. Could you imagine that? Petitioning him for rehabilitation. One morning during an ordinary Sunday worship service, the Lord sent tangible evidence that he had heard their prayers. Their church service was interrupted by an unexpected guest, an Algonquin Indian chief who assessed their hopeless situation and returned with a helper named Squanto. The pilgrims, who had warred with the Indians before and lived with a continuous fear of being attacked by them, were astonished by their new friend's eagerness to provide much-needed assistance. And that'll remind you, the Lord answers in very mysterious ways. Squanto, the Patuxet Indian, who spoke perfect English, taught the pilgrims how to hunt game, trap beavers, and plant Indian corn, a staple that would eventually save their lives. When the harvest yielded more than the pilgrims could eat, Governor William Bradford, their elected leader, declared a day of public thanksgiving. He invited the chief of a friendly neighboring Indian tribe to join their tribute of thanksgiving. The pilgrims were excited to celebrate with their honored guest, but were completely shocked when he arrived with 90 other Indians. Although God had provided abundantly, their food supply would not accommodate a group of this size, and they had no idea how to feed their visitors. Despite their quandaries, all worries were soon dismissed. To their amazement and ever-increasing thankfulness, the Indians had brought with them 5 dressed deer and 12 fat wild turkeys. Over time, they taught the women how to make pudding, maple syrup, and an Indian delicacy, roasted popcorn. But the pilgrims' trials were far from finished. Their plentiful autumn was followed by a particularly tremendous winter, a treacherous winter. Unfortunately, the weather proved to be the least of their ailments. In November, a ship called the Fortune dropped anchor in their harbor. Aboard the ship were 35 more colonists who had brought with them no provisions, no food, no clothing, no equipment for survival. Additionally, the oppression of the physical environment had become almost unbearable. After a 12-week drought dried up their crops and withered their spirits, the newcomers' arrival had drained already inadequate food rations, and there was no obvious resource for sustenance. At their lowest point, the pilgrims were reduced to a daily ration of 5 kernels of corn apiece. In utter desperation, they fell to their knees, and guess what they did? Prayed for 8 hours unceasingly. Again, God heard their supplications. 14 days of rain followed that prayer. A second day of thanksgiving was declared. The neighboring Indian chief was again their honored guest. This time he brought with him 120 braves. The pilgrim feasted on the game and turkey as they had during the previous celebration, only this time one dish was different. The first course, served on an empty plate in front of each person, consisted of 5 kernels of corn, a gentle reminder of God's faithful provision for them. The pilgrims' humble response to their affliction is evidenced by their many writings, which express deeply thankful hearts. We can learn countless lessons about sincere thankfulness from their example. God commands us to live a life of gratitude and thanksgiving. As we've read in 1 Thessalonians 5:6-8, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. By teaching our children to have grateful hearts, we can prepare them to respond gracefully to life's trials. Give thanks. Could you imagine 5 kernels of corn being all that you had for an entire day's rations? And yet in the midst of that, they said, Lord, thank you. When they thought they couldn't make it another day, they were thankful and they prayed. And how did the Lord respond? First in the church service, here comes a guy that's gonna teach you how to really plant and thrive in this and how to hunt. And then it happened, you know what? That wasn't the end of the trial. God answered and, oh yes, we're done. Nope, there was still another hard winter ahead, right? And yet they came to a low point of desperation, and what was their response again? We better get down and pray and trust that God's gonna do it again, and he did. He responded again. Their withered up crops got 14 days of abundant rain to bring in a harvest. And my challenge is, as we, you know, look around at the circumstances that we're in our life, we have to come to this realization that I must give thanks. Unfortunately, sometimes when we come in to worship together, we look at somebody in this room or that comes to this church and we're not thankful for them. Think about if the pilgrims had not been thankful to these Algonquins. These guys shoot arrows at us. They set traps and we fall into them. They're constantly raiding us. I do not like that person. I will not give thanks for them. How would that have changed their circumstances? What would their future have been if that had been their heart's attitude? We've got to be thankful. We're called to thankfulness. We often choose ingratitude. Now, listen to that. We're called to being thankful, yet we choose ingratitude. What's the difference maker? My choice. I'm going to choose to respond with a grateful heart. I'm going to choose to respond in gratitude to God. You know, we often despise the gifts that God has placed in our lives. And then that lack of thankfulness gets directed towards people that God has placed in our lives, right? That can't be our heart's attitude. Let's learn. As we celebrate Thanksgiving this week, I want you to remember this story of the first Thanksgivings and realize the circumstances that they came out of. Thanksgiving didn't come out of just a bumper crop initially. It came out of a generosity from somebody else coming in and planting seeds that produced long-term fruit. And then the second one came out of bumper crops only because God sent the rain in the middle of a drought. And why did that happen? Because his people said, let's get on our knees and pray until we see the answer come. As we look at this idea, I want to look today at Colossians chapter 3. We're going to start in verse 12. If you have your Bible and want to turn there, I've got some notes on the screen. But as we think about being thankful for the body of Christ, there's a couple of things that we have to get in place in our lives to position ourselves to be that, have that heart of gratitude. And the first thing I want you to remember, and you can write this down, take it home, you are what you wear. All right, now, we can't always say that about ourselves because sometimes we like to dress fancy and we're not fancy people. You know, I'm perfectly fine in a t-shirt and a pair of jeans, but I'll put on a suit if I need to, and I'll happily strut that suit, you know. This is talking about in our spiritual lives. You are spiritually what you put on. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14, Paul writes this, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with a heart of mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If someone happens to have a complaint against anyone else, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so also forgive others. And to all these virtues, add love, which is the perfect bond. See, you have to ask yourself, who is Paul writing to really understand the others and each other kind of idea? He's writing to a church in a city called Colossae. He's writing to believers. So when he says forgive each other, who's he talking to? Believers, people in the church. We realize we wrong each other, we step on each other's toes, but what's he saying? Forgive each other. But before he even gets to that point, look what he does in verse 12. He says, therefore, as, and then he starts listing, the elect of God, holy and dearly loved, that's who you are. That's who you are. As a believer in Christ, you are the elect of God. You are holy because God looks at you through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. He sees you as holy, and he says that you are dearly loved. Now, why does Paul begin this passage, this section of the scripture, by reminding these believers who they are? Because you will often become what you're told you are. Do you realize that? A study was done of a minister that did prison evangelism. He said this, in doing prison evangelism, I've learned that many prisoners grew up hearing from their parent or parents that they would never amount to anything and would probably end up in prison. Thinking of themselves as losers, they became what they thought they were. God has specially selected believers, has set them apart for great things, and has made them the objects of his love. You see, when Proverbs says, life and death is in the power of the tongue, if you constantly tell something they're worthless, somebody that they don't mean anything, that they have no value, then they grew up hearing that all their life, they will struggle seeing that they have any value or any life or any worth. But if you constantly are, parents telling your children, I love you, you're wonderful, you're great, oh man, I knew you could do it. Come on, you can do it. I bet if you put your mind to it, you could figure it out. And you're speaking these positive words of life. Now, I'm not the positive preacher. You know what? I'm not all, you know, crazy word of faith side of life. You know, where if I just say, I think, oh, is that, I've got a sore in my mouth. I wonder if that's cancer, that I'm suddenly going to get cancer. Now, that I did get cancer in my mouth, and so I do get sores regularly in my mouth from the radiation, and I constantly check them and look at them and monitor them, and then they go away, and I think, oh, that was just a sore in my mouth, right? So I'm not saying that you go to the crazy end of this and just start speaking, drive by the dealerships over off of 35 and say, I'm going to drive a BMW. When you're rolling around in a Pinto, you know, you got to get BMW money before you can drive the BMW, right? I'm not saying just because you say it, it's going to happen. But when you are talking to people, children especially, they will become what they hear. And the prison system is evidence of that truth. So Paul is saying to believers, know this, you are the elect of God. Hallelujah. You didn't choose God, he chose you. Why? How can you say that, Pastor Chiara? Because before I ever did anything right, Christ died for me, right? God chose me. I'm the elect of God. He picked me out. I'm his favorite. You can say the same thing. I think God in his infiniteness can have multiple favorites, all right? So you can say, I'm God's favorite, you know? You can say the same thing. I'm not saying you're less favored, because we're the favored. We're the elect of God. He says we're holy. We're seen through the lens of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, that though we are human and fall short, God sees us as holy because of the sacrifice of Christ. We are dearly loved. Oh man, that amazing, incredible, unending, undying love of God is applied to your life. You've got to be reminded who you are. You know, some people, like I said, because of how you were raised, struggle with accepting that identity. But that's something you can speak over yourself every day. I am the elect of God. I am holy. I am dearly loved by my Father in heaven. And nothing in this world is going to change that. 2 Corinthians 5:17, you can write that down and look at it later, says, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. So if you are in Christ, you are new. The old life is no more. When you walk in Christ, remind yourself, I'm new. The old is gone. The new has come. I am the elect of God. I am holy. I am dearly loved. Say that to yourself. If you're struggling in that identity, say that. Teach that to your children, that that's who they are in Christ. Write it down. Highlight it. Underline it. Remind yourself regularly. This is who you are. You know, I said at the beginning, you are what you wear. And he says, as the elect of God, holy, dearly loved, he goes on in that verse to say, clothe yourself. Put a garment on. What's that garment I'm putting on? Mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another, which old translations say forbearance, and forgiving each other, or forgiveness. That's what your clothes should be as a Christian. If you are the elect of God, if you are in Christ and you're walking this new creation life, then you get to put on this new set of clothes. You know what that sounds a whole lot like? The fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5. Paul says kind of right along the same things. If you don't know what these things are, mercy or compassion means that you show sensitivity to the suffering. Kindness is having a sweet disposition or being thoughtful as you deal with other people. Humility means you have a realistic view of yourself and are willing to put other people ahead of you and other people's interests ahead of your own. Gentleness means you don't behave harshly, arrogantly, or self-assertedly, but consider others first. You know, and thinking about my battle with cancer, I was a harsh person more frequently than I should be prior to getting cancer. And sometimes I wonder if the Lord had me walk through that trial to teach me a little bit of gentleness. I hope you don't have to do the same thing. I'm just saying, you know, I don't know the heart of God, but I never drank, smoked, or chewed, and I got cancer of somebody that does. So why else would it happen but that the glory of God would be revealed in my life? And then I would learn some things that I couldn't learn any other way. So don't go that road. I'm saying that's a bad road to have to go down, you know. Patience is a quality of being long-suffering and self-restraining. The Lord taught me some patience in that process. Again, you don't want to go down that road to learn it. So start saying, Holy Spirit, make me patient. And then you'll probably be put in a situation where you have to learn some patience. You know, so be ready, because if you ask for that, the test will come quickly, and it'll be a pop quiz that you didn't study for, right? Students, all students are familiar with the pop quizzes you didn't study for. The importance of being patient is then clarified with this idea of bearing with one another and forgiving one another. Why? Because sometimes the people that we're closest to, we're least patient with. We kind of come up with these ideas of, they know me. They know how I am. They know I can't deal with that right now, especially I haven't had my coffee today, right? We use that little coffee as an excuse to be mean and short with each other. And I haven't had my coffee yet. Don't even talk to me. Wait a second. There's no coffee in the Bible, I hate to tell you. Look, he says being patient is long-suffering and self-restraining, but then he says bear with one another, meaning that you're willing to put up with others even to the point of your own discomfort. You know, that's bearing with one another, or forbearance if you've maybe got a King James. Putting up with somebody else even to the point of your own discomfort. And then he clarifies further this idea of patience with not just bearing with one another, but forgiving one another. Forgiving means you won't hold a grudge or a grievance against anybody. Forgiving means this, that you're willing to let it go even if the other person doesn't apologize for the wrongs they've done. Because let me tell you what unforgiveness is. Unforgiveness is a cancer that will form in your spirit life, because it will only affect you. The other person will have no idea that you're not forgiving them. It will not affect their life in one bit. But it will eat you alive. It will make you an ugly person from the inside out. And if you don't believe me, go meet some 85-year-old person that has been dealing with unforgiveness for most of their life. They don't look good here, because it started in here. I've met some unforgiving old people. They are mean and rotten to the core, and it looks like it in their countenance and their face. So patience is clarified in bearing with one another and forgiving one another. And then he kind of puts the final nail in that coffin with what? Jesus did it first. Jesus Christ forgave you of everything you ever did and ever are going to do. Before you ever did anything right, he died for you and forgave you. So because of that truth, forgive each other. Someone forgot your birthday, get over it. Move on in life, forgive them. Give them a little leeway because they cut you off in traffic. That's a hard one for me. I'm the Lord's working on me still, you know. Idiots. That's what my common thing is. And my kids hear that. They're like, Dad, these idiots around you. I'm like, shoot, I got to watch what I'm saying now because my kids are riding with me. They become the little parrot in your back seat. They just repeat whatever you say. That's how God's got to teach us sometimes. You know, and then he says that the final thing, the belt maybe that holds your outfit together or the stitching in these garments is love. And this word love is the word agape, describing this love. It is a love that does what is best for the other person. It's a simple way to remember what agape love is. It does what's best for the other person, and love is what holds all these garments together. You are what you wear. These words describe the spiritual clothing that you're putting on. If not, I encourage you, start today. Make it a habit. Lord, help me. Help me to have mercy. Give me a heart of mercy. Lord, help me to operate in kindness and humility. Lord, help me to be gentle with other people rather than just rushing to be harsh. Lord, help me to be patient as I bear with other people, even to the point of my own discomfort, and as I forgive people for the wrongs that they've done. Why? Because Jesus forgave me, and let me live a life that is stitched together by love. Secondly, write this down. Be controlled by peace and thanks. Let that be the control of your life. Wear what you're supposed to wear, but be controlled by two things, peace and thanks. Colossians 3:15, the next verse goes on to say, let the peace of Christ be in control in your heart, And then the parenthetical note, for you were in fact called as one body to this peace. And be thankful. If you'll let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, then you won't get overwhelmed by the little situations that you find yourself in life. Because you know what? You realize the power of God in his son, Jesus Christ, that could speak the world into existence, has my world in control. He's got the situations of my life under control. I don't have to worry. I can just be happy. Don't worry. All right. It's a fun little song. So you know what? Let the peace of Christ rule in your heart. For this is in fact as you were called as one body to this peace. Well, who's the body he's talking about? The church. And it was the church in Colossae, but does that apply to us in this church in Calvary Temple? Yes, and as we have fellowship with other Christians that are part of the body of Christ, does that spread over to them as well? Yes. Yes, as one body, we were called to peace. Well, how do we have that peace? We go back to the clothes we're supposed to put on. If we get those clothes on all right and stitch it all together with love, then as we deal with each other, then we say, you know what? Jesus has got it under control. We can handle this. We can do this. He goes on to say that then be thankful. You think back of the hardships of the pilgrims. What was their attitude? Thankfulness to God. You know, if you go even further back in that story, these people left England because of religious persecution, and some went to Holland, and Dutch was teaching my kids a little bit about Holland, and because that's where she's from. And then they went back to England, got on a ship, and headed to the New World. So they were trying to find a place where they could worship God freely, right? And that was their desire of their heart, which is why they came to the New World, because we could set up a place where we can worship God and be free from the Church of England that wants us to do it their way and do it the way that we feel like God is calling us to do. And so in that, their purpose in coming was to worship God. That's why they came. That's why they endured hardship, because they wanted to have a place where they could worship. And you think that had to be so intertwined in their life, this relationship with God and knowing him and being thankful, because you know what? They left probably warm houses and cities that had some rudimentary services available that made life a little bit more easy. But the most important thing in their life was this relationship to God, and it wasn't easy. So they said, I'm going to give up my physical comforts so that I can have spiritually what I need. Right? Would we be willing to do that? That is, you think about the depth of that commitment to go float in a boat at sea and hope you eventually get to the right place for months. It was thankfulness was ingrained in them. And we live in a country where everything is pretty easy. You know, almost everybody in the United States is in like the top percentile of the world as far as, you know, what we consider poor. Those people most likely have a cell phone and a flat screen TV and a warm house, right? Even homeless people I see have cell phones. You go to what's poor in the rest of the world, it's none of that. It's hoping for a few grains of rice for a meal, right? That's poverty in the rest of the world. So we get this first world problem of taking for granted the things that we're blessed with, and we have to develop thankfulness because of that. And Paul says, as you've been called, you know, let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, because as a body, that's what we're called to, this peace in Christ, be thankful. Don't take for granted what God has blessed us with and what so many people labored and struggled for that we now get to enjoy. Other people worked hard in the soil. We're enjoying the benefits of the fruit now. The harvest is coming in. So don't take that for granted. Be thankful. You know, one commentator said this, when Christians need to make choices, the peace that Christ produces in our hearts should be a determining factor. Let that peace so be a part of your life that as you're making decisions in your life, if you don't have a peace about something, you don't go forward with it. And if you do have the peace of Christ in your heart about it, you do go forward with it, because you're like, this is where the Lord is leading me. Let the peace of Christ control you and be thankful. The third thing I want you to remember today, being thankful for the body of Christ. You know, you are what you wear. Let peace and thankfulness control you. The third thing, what goes in will come out of you. What you put in will come out. He goes on to say in verses 16 and 17, let the word of Christ, you remember we talked about the peace of Christ in 15. Now he says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and exhorting one another with all wisdom, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, all with grace in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This idea of being thankful just keeps running through time and time again. Dr. Constable summarized these verses by saying this, his word should permeate our whole being so that we make all decisions and all plans in his light. The word of God should be planted so firmly inside us that it controls our thinking and our actions. Let the word of Christ be planted firmly in you. If you don't like the fruit of your life, it's time to examine the seed that you're using. Right? We can get in this complaining mode, but sometimes we have to take a little introspection and look and say, am I creating the situations that I am in? Is what is coming into me coming out, and I don't like what it is, then you've got to change what's coming into you. If you want the clothes that he talks about in those previous verses, the spiritual clothing, how does that come? But by the word. It is our handbook, our rule for faith and practice. For every part of our lives, we've got to get what we are from the word. Paul says that you want it to dwell in you richly, right? You don't always have to, you know, send me a Facebook message and say, hey, Pastor Jr., what's the Bible say about this? Because you can find it just as easily as I can, and I'm going to give you a little hint. Google helps me almost every time. Google is one of my favorite Bible study companions. Why? Because I could say, what does the Bible say about giving cheerfully? And you know what? Google will tell me what the Bible says about giving cheerfully. In fact, it'll most often come to a website called Open Bible, and then it will give me like 15 verses, if there are such verses, on whatever topic I'm looking for. And so if you've asked me a question, where in the Bible does it talk about this? I didn't tell you because I have it all memorized. I read it regularly, I try to memorize, I get numbers mixed around, so a lot of times I'll say a verse without giving you a reference because I'm pretty sure that my brain probably flip-flopped some of the numbers in that reference, and I could tell you 613 and it's 316, right? And I just kind of have my brain, I know it. So if you ask me, I'll probably pull my phone out and I'll do a quick Google search and I'll look it up. Oh, it's right here. This is where it's at, right? I know it, I sometimes need help with where I know it, right? Let it dwell in you. Let it live in you. Let it grow in you. The next portion of Scripture says, let Christ's word dwell in you richly, and the overflow of that indwelling word of Christ is exhortation and teaching to other people. He's talking about the body still here. Paul is writing to Christians, and I believe that this still applies to us. Let me just encourage you with this. Be careful about who you allow to speak into your life. Okay, if this person is not allowing the word of Christ to dwell in them, I don't know that you want to trust the overflow that is trying to come to you in a way of teaching or exhortation. If you've got somebody that is, you know they are a person that is in the word, that is reading the word, that is studying the word, that is letting the word dwell in them richly, then you can most likely trust that the overflow of that person's life and teaching or exhortation to you will be according to the word. And that's where you've got to come back to. You know what? The Bereans are noted in the Bible because they listened to the teaching and went back to the word to make sure that what they were saying was true. And we're encouraged to be like the Bereans that listen to a teaching. Don't take everything I say as gospel truth. I'm pretty confident that I'm getting it right. But go to the word yourself and fact check me. Don't treat me like a politician. You know, politicians from every side all the time, they say whatever fits against what their opponent says and for what they want, and they all flip-flop, right? They're paid flip-floppers. They're like paid pancakes. All of them do it. You can guarantee that if a politician is for something and it's not an election year, they might be against it once the election year comes around, right? We all know that's what they do. That's why we have to, hey, wait a second. I'm going to fact check that for myself and see what I believe, not just listen to what everyone's telling me, right? Do that with the word. You hear something on TV, go back to the word. Is that really what the Bible says? You hear something in church, in a Sunday school, in a sermon, take it, write it down. I'm going to check that out for myself and see if that's for me. And he goes on to say that this teaching, once the word of Christ is indwelling in us richly, it's overflowing to each other in what? In all wisdom, singing psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, all with grace in your hearts to God. Isn't that awesome? Does that sound boring? No. It doesn't sound boring. I don't think God created us to be boring. It sounds like fun. You know, maybe we can just treat it like a musical. You can just like sing everything to each other. My sisters do that sometimes when we're home. My sisters will just turn into musical mode and conversations become songs versus talking. And it's funny, and maybe my sisters are weird and I'm weird because I think it's funny, but I don't know. But he says, you know, as you are letting the word of Christ dwell in you richly and it's overflowing to each other, let that come out in wisdom and singing psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, all this covered with the grace of God flowing out of your heart. Let that joy come out, not just some dry, boring stuff, right? We can joyfully be involved in each other's lives as we encourage each other to dwell more deeply in Christ and his word. We're called to be a body. We're called to be family. And Paul ends this section of scripture. He says, whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. One writer said this, we should say all words and practice all deeds in harmony with the revelation of Jesus Christ, namely under his authority and as his followers. Because we are the elect of God, holy and dearly loved, we should clothe ourselves with humility, kindness, gentleness, bearing with one another, forgiving one another, letting the word of Christ dwell in us richly because we're called to peace with one another and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Let that overflow in exhortation and encouragement to one another, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, all with thanksgiving to God. And everything you do in word or in deed, let it all be done according to his word and his will for your life. See, you take something and I've been reading this verse now for like 2 weeks. So I didn't quote it exactly to you right now. But that's the point, right? Let that sink into us and dwell in us and flow out of us so that everything that we do is done because of the revelation of Jesus Christ through God. Let that be who we are. You know, with that old saying, what would Jesus do, might be cliche, but it fits right on point. If you're in doubt when you're saying or doing, is this what Jesus would do? Because you know what? Jesus forgave. Jesus walked in humility. He walked in power and authority when the situation called for it. We look at the life of Christ and say, this is a life that I should emulate. Not that I could ever do what Jesus did, but I can sure do my very best to try and do it every day. Let's stand together and pray this morning. Father, I thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you that it is alive and true in our lives. Lord God, I thank you that you have called us as the elect of God. I thank you that you see us as holy. Father, I thank you that we are dearly loved. Lord, I pray that you would help us to identify with that personally. And then I pray that you would help us to see each other in the same light. That we would see the people that are around us, other people that are walking in the faith in Christ, that we would see that they are also the elect, holy, and dearly loved. And because we see ourselves that way and because we see them that way, then, Lord, we will put on these garments that you've called us to wear, and we'll stitch them all together in love, and we will be thankful. And Christ, I thank you that your peace can rest in our lives, and as a body, that peace can rest in us because you've called us to peace and harmony with other believers in the faith. I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to apply these things to our lives, that this word would dwell in us richly, and that the overflow of what is planted in us would bring life and joy and peace to the people around us. In Jesus' name.